a great friend, a family, Dr. Kishore Nadkarni, who is practicing at Gujarat at the Nadkarni's 21st Century Hospital and Test Tube Baby Center across South Gujarat. Dr. Nadkarni was trained in endoscopy, infertility in USA, Australia, London, everywhere. And he is a great orator, a great person, a great, great person, and a great andrologist. So over to you, Dr. Nadkarni, for a journey towards andrology. What is the future, especially in the era of ICSI? Dr. Kishore.
Yeah, thanks. Right. How do we change this, though? He's giving.
Dr. Kishore's slides, please.
Yeah, he's giving. Okay, friends, I'm speaking on the current status as well as the future of andrology. Now, this terminology of andrology was discussed in ESHRAE and also in a meet that was held last year in 2019 in Cairo. So I'll just give you some of the highlights of that, and we'll go through this journey. Now, why evaluation of the infertile male is important? Now, male infertility is the cause in nearly 50% of infertile couples, and yet we keep sidetracking it. There is only a marginal increase in pregnancy rates after 30 years of ART practice. The average global live rates, birth rates are around 21 to 35% now. Is this good enough? Can it not improve? After development of ICSI, there is no incentive to develop new therapies for male infertility. ICSI only bypasses the problem rather than solving it. And in over 30% of the cases, women who are absolutely normal, who are ovulating normally, they have no problem with the uterus or tubes, are subjected to invasive procedures even though they are fertile. Next. So this was what was discussed in the Cairo workshop. And amongst the diagnostic testing for male and female infertility, the diagnosis and treatment of male and male infertility in the modern world, and the clinical management, of course, of male infertility, one of the other important thing that was discussed was the overuse of ICSI. Next. Now, clinical andrology is still not recognized, as all infertility now appears to be treated mainly by gynecologists who have often had no teaching in the subject of andrology. Even seminars and webinars that include clinical andrology are very few. Formal teaching in andrology is only occasionally included in the routine training of either the gynecologist or even the urologist for that matter. In many clinics, the diagnosis of male infertility relies solely upon the findings of a semen analysis. And these semen analyses are usually interpreted by a laboratory scientist who knows little or nothing of the clinical history or findings of the male. Now, if you can see here, there are of male infertility that are treatable. For example, retrograde ejaculation, erectile dysfunctions, even hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, many other hormonal problems, testicular failure, hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, they have medical treatments as well. Next. So there is a call for more responsible use of ART in male infertility. ICSI is not without its hazards. Problems with OHSS and high order of multiple pregnancy have to be dealt with, and the percentage of birth defects in IVF was around 7.2 in many of the papers now, and in ICSI a higher percentage of birth defects, 9.9% has been found in some papers. Otherwise, in normal delivery, the birth defects rate is around 2.8%. So the real question is, how many of these couples really had an indication to undergo ICSI? So overuse of ICSI should be avoided. Let us go to the basics, the male gamete and the male reproductive system. Now, the male reproductive, relatively simple anatomy, hides an overwhelmingly complex system. You can see that the testes has got lobules, multiple seminiferous tubules, and these all lead to the rater testes, from where you get, they go into the caput, the corpus, and the cauda of the epididymis, and then you have the efferent duct, the vas deferens, which ultimately opens into the prostatic urethra. And the spermatogenesis is an amazing process. You have spermatogonia, the first mitosis, then you have one meiosis, You have the second meiosis, primary spermatocyte and secondary spermatocyte. You have spermatids, and after spermatids, the compaction starts. There's compaction, and then you have sperms which are released in the sample, and they go through the genital tract. And you know what happens in the female reproductive system? They undergo hyperactivation, they undergo capacitation, and they undergo the acrosome reaction. So these are the different things that happen to the sperm all along, right from its formation to the fertilization. Next. And genetic and epigenetic are regulated processes. Now, there are more than 3,000 genes involved, but only 30 are there in the Y chromosome. So it's the sperm is an extremely compact, specialized type of cell, which has the head with the nucleus, mainly the DNA and other things, the centriole. Then it has the midpiece with the mitochondria, and it has a flagellar tail, which is the flagellar responsible for the So spermatozoon, is it only the carrier of the paternal genome? Frequently, the sperm contribution is overlooked because it is considered a silent vector whose only function is to deliver the paternal genome to the maternal oocyte. However, this is not exactly true. Sperm contributes so many things. It contributes the oocyte activation factor. Nearly 3,000 different messenger RNAs are also required for the development of synthesis of different development-related proteins. So the sperm genetic factors are vastly, chromatin is broadly divided into a vast majority of the protamines, and a smaller portion of 15% remains bound to histones and retains its nucleostomal structure. These are all attached to the sperm nuclear matrix attachment regions. Now let's go to this basic investigation of semen analysis. A good standardized semen analysis continues to be the first initial fundamental investigation. It has a sensitivity and specificity of nearly 89%. Now, sperm semen analysis cannot tell us if this man can conceive or not, except when there are no sperms or very low sperms. You can say this fellow will not conceive. He is azoospermic. But if the count is 1 or 2 million, you cannot guarantee that he will not conceive. And that is why the WHO criteria kept on changing. And today we have the fifth percentile values as minimum required for fertility. So why andrology progress is important? Because currently most cases of male infertility are treated medically or surgically, bypassing the genetic problem. And ever since the term andrology was introduced by the gynecologist Harold Sipkin in 1951, not really much progress has been made in male infertility. Semen analysis has been performed for nearly 70 years. And yet, even today, the value of this traditional investigation has been frequently questioned. WHO has frequently revised its semen parameters from to its latest now, right from 2010. So sperm counts have been declining. The first report came in 1991 by Carlson et al. That the average sperm counts have dropped from 110 to 55 million. And this, you know this, the fifth percentile values, I'm not going to read them out. Next. So let us go to the lifestyle factors. One of the things that was discussed even in ASHRAE as well as in the Cairo workshop was that lifestyle factors and comorbidities and environmental concerns significantly affect sperm counts. Let's go to some of these causes. Temperature of the testes, so important. You're going with tight underwears, you're driving two wheelers for a long time, you're going and having sauna baths very regularly, working in welders and people with hot temperatures, exposing your testicles to microwave radiation, to other radiations, to cell phone radiations. All these are important, but the most important thing is the oral things. What are the different consumable items? Obesity, of course, is very important. Obesity, now nearly 50% of patients coming to our OPD have a BMI of more than 30. Now, excess fat causes increase in sex hormone binding globulin and thus reduce the testosterone levels. It also acts by inducing sleep apnea and altering hormonal profiles, reduced inhibin B and androgen levels, and increase estrogen levels and increase in scrotal temperatures. The diabetes is the other important thing. And you have these environmental, these life care products, all these chemicals that we use from morning till night, all contributing chemicals to the body, which can have an endocrine disruptor mechanisms at work. Next. You have plastic waste, pesticides, personal care products, medications, hormonal waste, and I want to tell you the most important thing is, of course, the oral things, tobacco, nicotine, coffee, alcohol, anabolic steroid abuse. excessive consumption of estrogens. So you really need to have an inventory of the person in the history of a complete questionnaire and really grade them or give them points as to what are their lifestyle factors that need modification. Diabetes mellitus, another very common thing. Again, 50% of patients coming to the male infertility OPD have diabetes mellitus. So all these things are very, very important in history and they need correction. Next. Most of these things also, including varicoses, leukocytospermia, cancer, idiopathic infertility, are acting through the mechanism of, even heat for that matter, act through the mechanism of reactive oxidant species. Now, there's something called sperm dysgenesis syndrome. This occurs, this word was coined in the Montreal FIGO, which I attended Salim Dias conference in 2004 in Montreal. And what is this dysgenesis syndrome? Now, in intrauterine life, the genital ridge is formed in the sixth week. The Leydig cells are developed in the eighth week of intrauterine life and stimulated by the HCG that comes from the placenta, mother's placenta. They secrete testosterone, the Leydig cells. Testosterone gets converted to dehydrotestosterone by the enzyme 5-alpha reductase. Now, in the 12th week of intrauterine life, dehydrotestosterone and AMH secreted by the Sertoli cells are responsible for the descent of the testes and disappearance of the Müllerian elements. So many things can go wrong at that time. And these are the things responsible for this maldescent, hypospadias, epispadias. In life, this can be responsible for declining sperm counts. The sperm counts were 100 million, but over the last 10 years, they have become zero. And also, they are supposed to be responsible for testicular cancer. Now, how does this DNA damage occur? Even due to ROS, how does the DNA damage occur? It may be in the form of single or double strand breaks, nucleotide modifications, base loss, telomere shortening. Mitochondrial DNA damage occurs first, and then the nuclear DNA damage occurs. And you can see here there are SSBs and DSBs which you can determine by a tunnel test, tunnel assay. Next. And what does DNA fragmentation do? There is a plethora of evidence linking DNA damage with every single fertility checkpoint. You can have impaired fertilization, slow early embryonic development, reduced blastulation, reduced implantation, miscarriages, low birth weight babies, birth defects, and even childhood cancers. So they can act anywhere. And you have different sperm DNA fragmentation tests, SCD tests, sperm chromatin dispersion tests is the test that we frequently use. That is the HALO test. You also have tunnel assay, COMET test. There are different tests. I'm not going into the details. But SDF tests can supplement conventional semen analysis and improve clinical values. Now, both do not recommend routine use of these tests, but there are specific indications for these tests. Now, how do you manage oxidative stress-related infertility? First is lifestyle modification, control diabetes, reduce obesity, get the weight down, stop smoking, reduce alcohol, have a good diet, and reduce stress. Then avoid activities hitting the scrotum. Use proper ventilation and personal protective equipment. This is going to become more and more important with COVID around the corner now. And treatment of infections and varicoceles is also important. And of course, antioxidants, vitamins, and food supplements. Stop tobacco, stop excessive coffee, and all the dietary measures that need to be taken. You have different antioxidants. Levocarnitine, acetyl-levocarnitine, and coenzyme Q10 are the latest molecular medicines that are prescribed. And they reduce oxidative stress and they prevent damage to the acrosome and midpiece and reduce DNA fragmentation. They also stimulate the mitochondria and increase energy production and stabilize the cell membrane. And again, a lot of Cochrane reviews. This was the 211 meta-analysis showing that oral antioxidant supplementation is useful and 2 to 3 months. Now, why are sperm counts dropping? I mentioned that they are dropping, and they are indeed dropping. Today, we have people, when you ask them to give volume, they hardly give you 1 ml. You look at the counts, 7 million, 1 to 2 motile sperms. Why are they dropping? Is the sperm heading for extinction? And you have this anthropologist theory that men are basically, why this is happening anthropologically? Because men are basically polygamous animals struggling to accommodate a woman's need for monogamous support. Now, we all have a biological mission. And that is to transmit our genes to the next generation. Here, the male and the female have two different reproductive agendas. The male has to just deposit his sperms, whereas the female has a much bigger involvement in reproduction. She has to get pregnant, she has to carry the baby, and she has to survive the baby up to the age of 1 year. And we have codified and complicated mating with the nation of marriage. If he was given the choice, men would have had to love to mate with many, many, many number of females. But evolution chooses the strategy that is most likely to lead to the greatest number of offspring surviving to the next generation. That is why, and look at the difference in the fertility status. This itself predisposes the male sperm to head for extinction. The whole species can get extinct. Human female species has 6 million eggs in her ovary. By birth, 2 million. By puberty, few hundreds. And the most fecund woman releases 450 eggs in her entire lifetime. By contrast, the male has 150 million new sperms every day throughout his life and releases genetic information in a single ejaculate to repopulate half the United States of America. And all these sperms have to wait for one oocyte that may or may not be released once on the day of ovulation, once every month. Too much. Again, the woman gets pregnant, males, and she has a lot of responsibility. Males have no such biological responsibility, hence they look for other partners. So according to Laura Betzig, men have the potential to father many more children than the woman can bear. They should have been selected to compete for both the number and quality of mates. So the Homo sapien of the literate society has united two different reproductive agendas of two different animals, one from Mars and one from Venus, by adopting very clever sexual strategies like marriage, by a very powerful combination of culture and biology. So the sperm today faces the inexorable threat of extinction because monogamy, which the man has adopted, is anti-evolutionary. The Y chromosome thrives on selection and competition, which it is being deprived of by monogamy. Let me give you some evidence. According to Jim Graves from the Australian University in Canberra, unlike other chromosomes, the Y chromosome is a genetic wasteland full of genetic junk, has only 45 genes. In fact, all important gene expressions have SRY, even the including the SRY, have partners on the X from which it has evolved. And in the last 300 million years, the Y chromosome has lost 1393 out of 1438 of its original genes and will lose the remaining 45 genes in the next 10 million years, after which man will have to resort to asexual reproduction. So beware, males, be careful. Let's go to some of the current management things that we will discuss next. Current status. Hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, many different ways of treating it, but we adopt this Borges's method, which is started 6 months prior to planned parenthood. We give gonadotropin 2000 international units 3 times a week for 6 months, and after 3 months, we add REC FSH 150 international units for the next three months, and 80% of azoospermic men will have sperm in the ejaculate in the above time within 6 months. Now, this is not always possible because compliance is a problem, cost is a problem. So many times we give this treatment, we replace, instead of REC FSH, we give HMG, and we give this treatment for 12 to 18 months. Now, there is a medical management of non-obstructive azoospermia in hypergonadotropic hypogonadism or testicular failure. In these cases, the testes are usually damaged or small. The FSH is high, the testosterone is low, and there is an imbalance between the circulating testosterone and estrogen with an altered T to E ratio of less than 10. Standard treatment today, we have got 50 cases so far. We are awaiting results of all the cases to publish this. And you can give stimulate or whatever, letrozole, 2.5 milligrams once a day for 60 days for 2 months. And you can also add 2,000 international units of HCG 3 times a week for 2 months. Now, both these treatments given before doing sperm retrieval significantly increases the chances of retrieval. Even the chances of getting sperms in the ejaculate are there. Even the testicular volume, if you measure it very carefully, as per the literature, you can get actually an increase in the testicular volume as well. Next. For testes, you need to give gonadotropins for at least 2 to 3 months. You can even give it as long as you want. One of the favorites of andrologists is gonadotropin to males. Not testosterone. Aromatase inhibitors may be steroidal or non-steroidal. We prefer to give anastrozole 1 milligram or letrozole 2.5 milligrams. Next. Now we'll come to varicocele treatments. Clinical established varicoceles with altered semen parameters improve with surgical management, surgical treatment. No two things about it. There is enough evidence for that. Microsurgical varicocelectomy comes nearest to being the ideal operation and is the gold standard operation. Even in azoospermia, varicocele ligation may result in appearance of sperm in the ejaculate and may improve the chance of sperm retrieval. However, this largely depends on the histopathology of the testes, and they say that if the histopathology shows hypospermatogenesis or late maturation arrest, the chance of the patient with azoospermia getting sperms on retrieval improves. But if the patient has Sertoli cell only syndrome or early maturation arrest, there is practically no chance of operating a varicocele. So a small microneedle biopsy is important. What is the future of microsurgery in varicocele? In future, robotic systems in microsurgery will blend optical magnification with robotic control. In microsurgery for varicocele, ultimately, and the world is working on it, reliable, safe, effective treatment that does not involve a surgical incision will emerge. And this will be the holy grail for varicocele as far as urologists are concerned, as per Masson and Runigan. This is the latest publication. Sperm retrieval techniques. If there is no problem, put a needle, you get in obstructive vasospermia, you get sperms. MISA can be done, but not done anymore, hardly done, because PISA is very, very effective. In non-obstructive vasospermia, you can do TISA, you can do multiple TEFNA, or you can do a TISA. TISA is preferred, you can do multiple TISA. But in certain cases, you need to do a micro-TISA. What are the indications of micro-TISA? Micro-TISA is done when the testicular volume is less than 10 ml. It is done when TISA has failed, when multiple attempts at TISA have failed, person insists on his own sperms. It can be done in hypogonadotropic hypogonadism where the testicular volume is low, Klinefelter syndrome, and even in badly damaged testes, you can look for, because the premise is that whatever the FSH, whatever be the testicular damage, certain focal areas of spermatogenesis may be found in part of the testes. So this is the premise. Next. And you can see the indications that if the testicular volume is more than 10 ml, multiple TCA will give as good results, but if it is less than 10 ml, micro TCA is the procedure of choice. And if you can do it for 3 to 4 hours, the searching part, then the results can be 35 to 77. Not an easy procedure, my dear friends. It requires a very good lab, it requires patience, and it requires a team. I've seen this being done by Sandra Estes in Campinas. And so I really feel that we should have andrology labs like that, dressed up like astronauts. We do this in COVID days, we have a chance to do that, but really, it's a great thing to do. Next. This is the micro TCA dissection. I'm not going to go to the videos. And now you have something new. You have a morphometric evaluation of the seminiferous tubules. You can actually, using advanced optics, you can actually measure the diameter of the individual tubule. One single large tubule, and you can sometimes even see the sperms within that tubule using optics. And so you can actually decide which sperm has got cells or sperms inside it. Next. There are other novel methods of identification of sperm production sites in TCA and micro TCA with non-obstructive, for patients with non-obstructive vasospermia. And these are coming up with using different color studies and different colored optics. Next. Let's come to future prospects. What does the future hold in andrology? What is going to happen 20 years? The era of biomarkers. You have genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, and metabolomics of the sperm and the semen. Next, semen fluid, seminal fluid. Proteins are critical in understanding disease. You have genome, transcriptome, proteome, and the metabolome. Detect the proteomes, different proteins by mass spectroscopy, Raman spectroscopy, and nuclear magnetic resonance. There is a beautiful paper of a change in proteomic profiling after in the seminal plasma in adult men before and after varicocelectomy. So studying the proteins of the semen in the seminal fluid can actually, that is the proteomics, can actually tell us a lot of things. Next. Proteomics and metabolomics will offer potential discovery of new biomarkers, SA heparin binding proteins, prolactin inducible protein, human serum albumin, and human cationic antimicrobial protein and spindling. Now you have genetic considerations. I'm not going to read this out, but you know that, next, that these are the two tests that we do. We have two tests available to us in males. Nucleotide, it tells you a lot of things about autosomal disorders as well as sex chromosomal abnormalities. And you do the YQ microdeletions, which tells you the microdeletions in the long arm. And for the short arm, you need to do specific gene study. You can do a gene fish or the NGS technology. You can diagnose or identify the CFTR gene mutation, which is usually accompanied by cystic fibrosis and results in congenital bilateral absence of VAS. The future genomics, 1 minute, please. Previous slide. Future genomics and microarray systems will be able to survey small genomic regions, including nucleotide aberrations. Gene therapy using viral and non-viral vectors will look to deliver missing genetic factors within the testes to aid sperm production. This is going to happen in the future. Next. And how? DNA microarray technology. Glass or silicon slides with thousands of features are arrayed. Gene expression is measured by the hybridization process, and microarrays are read using laser-based fluorescence scanners. The normalcy and the abnormalcy of the sperm chromatin content can be actually studied by a single drop, single microarray. Different publications, microarray analysis in sperm from fertile and infertile men reveal significantly different transcriptome. Next. And you have a microarray technology is a powerful tool capable of measuring simultaneously expressions of thousands of genes expressed in a single sample. They say now that 20 years from now, along with a semen sample, you will have to give 1 ml of blood and they'll give you the report of 1000 genes related to male infertility and will be able to point out that this gene is responsible for that. And through gene therapy with a vector, you'll be able to inject that gene into the retro testes or into the testicular substance. That's going to happen, my dear friends. Next. So microarray technology is also being used to identify new genes, and Cheng and colleagues have identified a novel testis specific gene, MCAK homolog. Microarray technology will allow for rapid access to a more precise diagnosis and better therapeutic strategies of various diseases. So you have molecular genetic fingerprinting, next, and you have seminal fluid molecular genetic fingerprinting. What is all this? These are all the same findings of microarray and proteomics, which are coded. Coded means they are put into a language which the computer can identify, and they are stored, that information is stored. And ultimately, all these 5D, 5G, and you know, the artificial intelligence will be able to get all this technology through a single press of a button, maybe. Next. You have fertility cryopreservation, sperm, spermatids, embryos, oocytes, ovarian tissue, testicular tissue, even male germ cells. Now, this is the common question. Can you preserve your sperms? Can you preserve my sperms? Yes. Can you preserve a child's testicular tissue? Can you preserve a child's spermatogonial stem cells? This is what they're working on. Cryopreservation treatments pre-puberty for patients who are suffering from childhood cancers. This is the challenge, and they are doing it. Next. Then vitrification of retrieved sperms. Retrieved sperms are delicate, fragile, and sometimes immature, with only a twitch to indicate its vitality. Freezing and vitrification of retrieved sperms requires careful handling and a very good lab. Now, I thought it was easy, but the embryologist at the end of the 6 hours, you know what happens when you wear the PPE kit for 2 hours, you start sweating and even getting wet inside. They wear this astronaut kit for 6 hours in Sandro Esti's lab in Campinas, and they were working hard for identifying. I attended a workshop even in Ashraf's place in Kochi. Testicular tissue vitrification and testicular tissue cryopreservation is already being. Now we come to another thing. Spermatogonial stem cell preservation and transplantation. Next. Spermatogonial stem cell transplantation into a rhesus monkey. An azoospermic rhesus monkey regenerated normal functioning sperms, and the patient with this rhesus monkey was able to get the sperms in the ejaculate. Now, this was not now, this was in 2012, this paper. Now, if the rhesus monkey can have this, why can't a human being have this? There are issues. Spermatogonial stem cells maintain spermatogenesis throughout a man's life and may have applications for treating some cases of male infertility, particularly those caused by chemotherapy before. So it's the SSC, spermatogonial stem cells, that are important. And where do you inject those spermatogonial stem cells? Through a ultrasound guided retro testes identity, small needle into the retro testes. And there's a video of this. I'm not going to show you. Let's go on. Spermatogenesis is a complex process that originates in a small population of spermatogonial stem cells. Here we report in vitro culture of spermatogonial stem cells that proliferate for a long period of time. There are at least 5 papers recent after 2016 that I have been able to access. Next. Because spermatogonial stem cells are the only stem cells in adults that divide to contribute genes to subsequent generations, they are the ones that are valuable for biological experimentation, medical research, and biotechnology. Just to tell you a brief thing, that you have different stem cells. ES is embryonic stem cells. EG is germline, EG is embryonic germ cells. GS is germline stem cells. And SSC is spermatogonial stem cells. Out of all these, germline stem cells and SSCs are the only ones that can be injected into the testes without fear of inducing a teratoma. If you inject the other two, there's a high chance of you giving a cancer to the patient. Now let's come to the last part, and that is COVID-19. 3 months ago, there was a report saying that the COVID-19 was detected in the semen of COVID-positive patients. So there are rising concerns on damage to the testes due to COVID. As you all know, rapidly dividing cells in viral infections affects those cells, ASC2 cells, alveolar cells, all like mumps, measles can cause orchitis, similarly affect. So it is not hard for people to conjecture that testes may be infected by a virus which can lead to some reproductive problems. So these were the questions asked to the andrologist. What is the answer? Next. So ACE2 and tissue injury. ACE2 is an expression that is not limited to lung cells. It is also found in the vascular endothelium of the heart and also found in the lining of the testicles, in the seminal vesicles, in the seminal germ cells. A recent single cell RNA sequencing showed this receptor to be found in germ cells, Leydig cells, and Sertoli cells. Thus, the testes could be another target of this virus. Time will tell us. Now, this is a study that was done in people above 65 years of age, which showed that the AC2 expression was diffuse in the Sertoli cells, but strongly present in the Leydig cells, but zero in the spermatogonial cells. So it is the spermatogonial cells that are the virgin cells. All of the cells can get infected potentially. More studies are needed. Next. So study findings suggest that studies should be now undertaken to find ways to mitigate. These are, of course, lab things. We do not, in our clinical practice, we cannot do these studies. Studying the Leydig cells. How do we find the Leydig cells clinically? So these are all lab techniques. And this is something where we fundamentally, our DNA and the scientist's DNA is different. Stem cells, I went to animal labs. And then when I attended that, I found that the other people sitting there belong to a different species. I was the only one out. And this SARS and CO, this SSG3 and SS4, it was all going above my head. I could understand nothing out of that. So COVID-2 infection is expressed in germ cells and suggesting that testes is a potentially tropism site for virus. These findings can provide evidence-based guidance for sperm donation. Now, for donation, it's going to be important. People ask you, did this fellow have a subclinical? Get a COVID report first and inform management strategies. So as Rishikesh was saying, for the they were discussing the guidelines for COVID and sperm. So I'm sure I would also be waiting for those guidelines to come out. Next. So to conclude, my dear friends, novel genomic and proteomic biomarkers could add to the workup and clinical treatment strategies. Microarray technology offers a novel tool for diagnosis and identification of therapeutic targets for male infertility. Identification of specific genes will pave the way for gene therapy. Interesting, this is. Put your children into genetics, make them go to USA and work in good genetic labs, and they'll come back really rejuvenated with a different mindset. Transplantation of SSCs can result in spermatogenesis in non-obstructive azoospermia, and prospects in creating sperm from immature and somatic cells will emerge. Novel methods will emerge for identification of sperm production sites in non-obstructive azoospermia and fertility preservation, cryobanks, embryo banks, oocyte banks. All this is going to assume great importance in the future. Thank you very much for a patient hearing. Thank you, Eris Pharma. Thank you, Narendra Malhotra. Thank you, Himanshu Bavishi and Rishikesh Pai for being there for this lecture and for sharing the stage with me. And wish you a safe and healthy next 2 to 3 months, by which time we should be able to conquer COVID. Bravo.